I'm going to speak in English because I've always found it impolite that people speak in their own native language in front of other people who don't understand. There are probably N minus one people here who speak Portuguese, but there is one who should understand what I'm going to say. It's a great honor to welcome Jeff Hodgson here today on behalf of the Institute of Economics, and a great pleasure for me personally. I've known Jeff for many years now, and I've been a great admirer of his work. And there would be far too much to say about his work, not least because he's extremely prolific, absurdly prolific, I would say. He's written so many articles and books and good stuff, published in several good journals and books published by very good publishers, that one wonders whether there is only one Geoff Hodgson or many. So maybe this is not the original Geoff Hodgson, but one of his many clones.
Yeah.
So that would be part of the question about his work, but there is no need actually to say much because he's quite well known. In fact, he's one of the best known and most widely cited heterodox economists in the world in any field. And he's even more distinguished in his own field of specialization, which is institutional economics. I would say that he's the main responsible for the revival of institutional economics from a heterodox perspective in the last decades. He's not only that, but I think, and in my opinion, and I think in the opinion of many other people, he's the very best heterodox institutional economist in the world today, and has been for a couple of decades. So, welcome, Jeff. He's going to talk about inequality, why someone would choose the topic of inequality to give a talk in Brazil, I don't understand, but I hope you will. So let's hear from him.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, David, for that very kind, maybe too kind, introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here again. It's my second visit to this university. Can you all hear me okay? So the mic is not for internal, it's external. Okay, it's not. It's no personal attack or national attack to talk about inequality, because I think although levels of inequality differ in different countries, every country in the world faces this problem to some degree. In Britain, historically, the level of equality compared with Brazil, say, has been less, but it's increasing quite dramatically. So my country has this problem as well. It's getting worse. So I want to talk about some facts about inequality. I want to talk about how we explain it, and then also consider some policies. Policy area is very difficult, but I think we have to think about it. So this is the structure of my talk. It's a kind of contradiction of capitalism, if you like, that one of the original slogans of capitalism is liberté, égalité, fraternité, liberty, equality, and fraternity. Quality being key, the idea of breaking down the old feudal order where you have kings and landowners and aristocrats and putting everyone on the same legal footing and establishing equal rights, as expressed in the slogan of the French Republic, still there on the official French documentation. And it's a kind of contradiction that capitalism did create legal equality at different times, at different rates. The French Revolution established legal equality for men, at least. Women, equality came later, and that's a different story in different countries. In Brazil, you were relatively late abolishing slavery. The US was also late abolishing slavery. Abolished slavery after the Civil War, as you know, in the 1860s. So this move towards equality under the law, where we more or less have equal rights. In Britain, we still have a queen, so there's some inequality of the law with the monarchy still there. But there has been a progressive, more or less, move in most countries towards equality under the law over the last 200 years. But economic inequality has got wider, okay? It's got worse, generally speaking. So it is a sort of contradiction that you have a leveling in terms of rights, formal rights, but economically the gap between rich and poor, the rich and the powerful and the others, is increasing. Here's some figures. I'll have to sort of focus in to explain what's going on. The type is rather small. If you can follow me over there on this one, it's Australia, Brazil, China, France, etc. going down. Well, this is first of all for wealth, okay, so I'll talk about income in a minute. The point I want to make is not that there's two points I want to make. One is that generally speaking, as far as we've got data, say the top 10%, you have quite large concentrations of wealth in the top 10%. Actually, there was a figure released in Britain, if I remember the figure exactly, 2 days ago. One report said the richest, I think it was 7 families in the UK, have the same wealth as the bottom 20%. Right? So just 7 families have the same wealth as the bottom 20%. There are different ways of expressing this, but we do have, in many countries, including the most developed countries, high levels of concentration of wealth. Even in places like Switzerland, which is third row from the bottom, very, very, very high. And also in countries which, like Sweden, which has an egalitarian ethos and a social democratic history, it's still relatively high. The rightmost column is the Gini coefficient, and as you know, the Gini coefficient is another measure of inequality. The higher the coefficient, the higher the level, so you can compare, and Brazil comes in with this data at particularly high, one of the highest. Another high one is actually Sweden, surprisingly high, and Switzerland again, and USA also high. And you can see the differences there. One point that also true is that we do have variation across countries. So the fact that we have variation across countries, I mean, no country is particularly wonderful here, does suggest you can do something about it within capitalism. Okay? So I may have an argument with my Marxist friends who say, well, the only thing you need to to deal with the problem is have the socialist revolution, okay? And to destroy capitalism as we know it, and to expropriate the expropriators and so on. Well, maybe, maybe not, but the point is there's enough variation within capitalism, even by this data, to actually say we can do something within capitalism about this problem. So I would make that case too, although the scale of the problem is particularly severe. Now, you know what the Gini coefficient is, so I don't need to explain that to you. This is the distribution of income, which, of course, is a different story. And here we have enough data with most countries between 1970 and 2000 to track this through time. So we can both see differences between countries, and we can track through time. And in all but 3 cases, by the Gini coefficient, distribution of income has got more unequal. Okay, some, though, much more than others. The big growth in inequality, or one of the biggest, is Russia and the UK. Okay, so this again suggests that countries have a general problem with inequality, but some countries are changing more rapidly than others. And In a generally in a bad direction, more inequality. Whereas other examples, we have the 3 countries which are Italy, South Korea, and Spain, where inequality has been reduced in terms of income. Now, the original figures, the 1970 figures for those countries, show that they were actually higher. So there's slight evidence of convergence. Okay, so we. You may say, well, this is globalization or whatever, that may be right, but there's slight evidence of convergence. So while there have been changes, it's generally gravitating very, very slightly towards a mean. But at that rate, it would take a long time, and variety within capitalism is still going to be preserved. So I'm basically making a point, in favor of the literature or the arguments about the varieties of capitalism. And varieties of capitalism shows that there's scope within capitalism for some change to deal with this problem. Whether you need to go beyond capitalism or whether is a different matter, but we can discuss that. One of the great gurus of equality, a recently high-flying American economist, is Milanovic, and he's got data on, he's got the best data sets, I think, as far as I'm aware, on global inequality. Why is it the best data set? Because actually a lot of the previous data sets are either looking at inequality within countries and then comparing countries country by country, which is comparing aggregate with aggregate, rather than disaggregating and look at it from the bottom up globally. Okay, so you look at individual inequality globally. And depending how you look at this problem, you get a different story. So he gets this consistent story by actually getting improved data sets. And he shows, by going back into the early 19th century, that inequality has increased since the early 19th centuries, when capitalism takes off in the most developed part of the world, industrial revolution well underway, and this is associated with increased inequality. Then it reaches a high level, so it increases for about 150 years in about 1950, and then there's slower growth in inequality. His data is not sensitive to the more recent changes, but the trend is upwards, but less rapidly than it was in previous parts. So that's one thing that comes out of this big data sets which Milanovic has collected. Another thing he shows is that most global income inequality in the early 19th century was due to differences within countries. So countries are more similar than they are now in terms of levels of wealth and income, and therefore globally you could explain more of the inequality by differences within countries rather than between them. What's changed since then, as some countries have leapt ahead, is by the early 21st century most global income inequality is due to differences between countries. This is an important result because actually it has something to say about globalization, and I'll come back to that in a minute. So even though countries like China and India are growing very rapidly, the gap between, say, China and India on the one hand and the developed world on the other, say Europe, Western Europe, explains more inequality than the inequality within countries. The inequality within countries is huge, including within China and India, but more of the global inequality is explained by differences between countries rather than within countries. So it's again an important empirical result. I got interested in this guy. Have you heard of Thomas Paine? Yes, maybe. He's ritually cited, but interestingly, in the UK, he's an icon of the left. Okay, so and he's celebrated by the Communist Party left and the sort of old-fashioned British left. And there's a Thomas Paine Society, and Tony Benn was its president. And Tony Benn died last week, so there's a vacancy available. But in the United States, he's celebrated as a libertarian. Okay, so he has a kind of paradoxical position. So the left excuse is that he's a pre-socialist. Okay, his dates are such that the word socialism hadn't been invented, and the sort of hand-waving excuse here is if socialism had been ideologically developed, he would have been one. But actually, I doubt it. Anyway, just whatever explanation of his position, he focuses very much on the issue of inequality. He actually defends a market economy, defends private property, but focuses on inequality. But he was a radical at the same time because he was involved both in the American Revolution and in the French Revolution. He was very nearly executed in the Terror, but then he went back to the United States and died in 1809. So I'm interested in Paine because later in my lecture I'm going to show you some of Paine's policy proposals to deal with inequality. But it's a nice a quotation from him about the spectacle of inequality. If you haven't read this book, I strongly recommend that you do. Okay? This is a book which is making a sensation. It's been out for about 5-6 years now. But the two authors are British authors, Richard Wilkinson and Kate Pickett. And basically, it's a set of correlations between certain things, certain negative outcomes concerning health, delinquency, all sorts of things, and inequality. And they compare different countries, the levels of inequality, and all the internal states of the United States, all 50 states of the United States. They're also treated as separate countries for the purpose of the analysis. And what they show, for example, is that using data, 23 countries and the separate states of the USA, they observe negative correlations between inequality and physical health, mental health, education, child well-being, social mobility, trust, and community life. And all these things are statistically significant in their analysis. So the social effects of inequality seem to be huge. And this is one of the most devastating critiques of inequality from that point of view, by gathering this data. And it's still being debated and still very hotly discussed in the UK and elsewhere. You also find positive correlations between inequality and drug abuse, imprisonment, obesity, violence, teenage pregnancies, all sorts of things. All that is laid out in the book. So it's a sort of book full of evidence that inequality isn't simply a matter of injustice or objectionable in its own intrinsic terms. It also has fairly catastrophic social effects. The less clear in the book, and also from subsequent discussion of the book, is why is that so? Why does it lead to more anxiety and so on? And the arguments are rehearsed rather than proved. And the argument is something to do with feelings of exclusion, social solidarity, the need for social solidarity, the need for belonging, the feelings of powerlessness, so psychological effects, which an unequal society might generate. But that's largely speculative, and I think there's more work to be done on this, and it had to be done by social psychologists and medical people and so on. But the evidence is there. The correlations are very, very strong. So we have to take note of that. Right, so the next section of the talk is what generates inequality? Okay, where does it come from? We know that it has negative effects. Where does inequality come from? What generates it? Well, obviously, a lot of the inequality we have that we see in front of us, like in Britain, the Queen, I think, or the monarchy is the biggest landowner, and I think the second one is the church, and the third one is Trinity College, Cambridge, and all three of those are feudal institutions. Okay, so in Britain, a lot of the inequality we see, particularly in terms of land ownership, comes from a pre-capitalist era. And no doubt about that. So a lot of inequality in many countries results from, in Brazil, colonization and powerful people grabbing more land than others and so on. And remnants of the past inequalities in many European countries will account for it. So historically, we can explain a lot of the inequality in those terms, but we need to understand also how capitalism generates inequality. So what does capitalism add to the story? Or does it? Okay? Maybe all the inequality we see in front of us in all these societies, or most of it perhaps, is a result of history. Or are there mechanisms within capitalism that make the problem worse? Now, the data by Milanovic suggests that there are, because the Milanovic data, the time series data from early 1800s, suggests that capitalism has generated more inequality from early 1800s through to about 1950, and then at a slower rate since then. So capitalism seems to be responsible for more inequality than we get from the feudal past. Okay, so what extent is so this is a question I raise. A lot of this inheritance will come from before capitalism, so we need to look at the post-capitalist period. We need to focus on the generators of wealth within capitalism, and that's the main theoretical problem to deal with here. I can go to the next one. Okay, let's bring Marx in, okay? Marx has an interesting explanation of inequality. Notice that Marx does not blame inequality on the market. He does not, okay? I've had arguments with Marxists about this, so I'll come to my arguments about the market in a minute. But if you're a Marxist, you don't believe the market's a problem. Unless you're an unorthodox Marxist, in which case you can amend Marx. But if you're faithful to Marx, then the explanation is not the market. The explanation is in the sphere of production. The inequality in capitalism for Marx is generated through the process of production. It's the expropriation of the workers of value through his theory of surplus value. You know the story. The worker works for 10 hours, creates so much wealth, and you measure the wealth by the amount of labor time in it, and the worker gets a wage which might be half of that value in terms of what it can buy in terms of embodied labor. So the half, the 50%, is taken away by the capitalist and becomes profit, and that generates inequality. Now it's true that workers work and they produce wealth. They contribute to products, or without them there wouldn't be the products that are sold on the market, which have a price, and without their labor there wouldn't be no profit, with the exception of an entirely automated factory, but let's leave that out for a minute. Where there's labor involved, which is most spheres of production, most parts of production, without the labor you would not have any profit. But the problem is that this argument is circular. The problem is you simply assume that labor is the source of all value, and then say the worker doesn't get all their labor time back. Okay? To say that the labor is necessary for production is not to say that it's the only thing necessary for production. Other things, other conditions are necessary for production to take place. So there's machinery and inputs and whatever. So production is, labor is necessary for production, but other things also are necessary for production. So assuming that labor is the source of all value is not, is simply demonstrating what you have to prove, because other things also could contribute to value. You can't simply assume it at the outset. Now, Marx assumed it at the outset because all other preceding economists, Smith, Ricardo, and Marx, all had the same idea about the labor theory of value. So the problem of the labor theory of value is its circularity, that it assumes that labor is a source of value and then demonstrates the workers don't get the value back. Let's deal with another figure, a living economist this time. This is Stieglitz, if you recognize him here. Now, Stieglitz is sort of center-left politically, and he's written actually quite an excellent book on American inequality. It's a popularly written book, but it's very important because it's inequality is an important issue in the States, and we very welcome his attention to that problem. But look carefully at what he says in that book, and he says things like, markets often lead to high levels of inequality. This is actually in the early pages of the book. So you imagine the book's going to tell you how markets generate inequality. But the further you read into the book, he doesn't actually tell you that. What happens is that he has a chapter on markets and inequality, which you open this chapter and you think, well, he's now going to explain to us how markets generate inequality. But he doesn't blame markets at all, but how they're shaped. Okay? Now, in a sense, markets can generate inequality. Because if you have asymmetries of power in the market, then people can manipulate prices by oligopolistic power or monopolistic power. They can drive out weaker competitors by manipulating prices, or lowering prices artificially for a while, for example, making them all bankrupt, then putting them up. So when we have oligopolistic or monopolistic markets, they can be manipulated by powerful actors to create more inequality. But that's, again, assuming something which kind of begs the question, because if you say that the source of inequality in markets is oligopolistic power, then you're not blaming it on markets as such, but oligopolistic markets. The question I'm raising is whether markets in general create inequality. So let's do the kind of textbook mental exercise. Let's just assume perfect competition. If you assume perfect competition, which in a sense Marx does as well in his discussion in volume one, if you assume perfect competition, then you're assuming away the possibility of oligopolistic interference and manipulation of prices and driving people out of the market. So it's less obvious that a perfectly competitive or close to perfectly competitive market would itself generate inequality, which suggests that the problem with markets is not markets as such, but potential oligopolistic or monopolistic power within markets. And again, Stieglitz again retreats from the statement that markets are to blame. There's another book which is called The Matthew Principle by a guy called Daniel Regney, and in there he has what's called the parable of the monopoly game. The book is about cumulative processes which create positive feedback effects. And the parable of the monopoly game, I think, is interesting. You all know the game of Monopoly, yeah? You're familiar with this. Okay. What are the names of the streets? Are they Rio Street or Sao Paulo Street? Favelas, are they? Okay, you go around and round the board. But if you play London Monopoly, you have different streets and whatever. Now, the Monopoly game, as you know, is a game with a little bit of skill in it and a lot of chance. And if you have people who are more or less sort of adult players or more or less similar skill, everyone will know that what you have to do is more or less grab the property you can at the beginning of the game. And then the more you grab, the more revenue you generate. And therefore, you get richer, and then you buy more property. Okay, so the first moves are crucial. Now, the first moves largely depend on luck. You may make strategic or tactical decisions that have positive or negative effects at the beginning, but it's largely luck, because sometimes you can get a lousy throws of the dice and you don't land on the right things. Sometimes you get good throws and you get the good properties and you buy them up, and it's cumulative. And as you know, in the game, once you get ahead, the whole thing becomes more so. Now, let's assume that this monopoly game is no longer a game of private enterprise when you are buying properties and charging rents. Let's assume that it's nationalized, okay? So if you have nationalized monopoly, you still have the same result. So you would have, instead of when you land on a property, you become the manager and charge a rent, and and you have a commission from the rent, so you 100% commission, so you pocket the money. The same effect would be there. So the fact you have this positive feedback process, which where those that get ahead get more ahead, and the more you're ahead, the more you get ahead, is irrespective of the structure of property rights. It would be true in a nationalized game of Monopoly as well as a privately owned one. Okay, so this example of positive feedback loops isn't market specific. It's more general than that. So briefly, I'm arguing that actually the simple statement that markets create inequality is either weak or wrong. It's wrong in a limited sense. Markets create competition and some people fail. Some people go under and go down the income scale. But that's also true when we swim in the sea. When we swim in the sea, some people are weaker than others and they drown. Do we blame the sea? No, we say we are a weaker swimmer. It's a combination of the two things. So the intrinsic weakness to the actor is also part of the story. So the next question is, if it's not simply markets, what about globalization? Does globalization create inequality? And I repeat the point I made earlier from Milanovic's work that the global inequality has increased since 1950. And this is the era of the modern era of globalization. But again, most global inequality is due to differences between countries rather than within countries. And this is important for the discussion. Now, if this is true, the last sentence is also possible. It's possible for inequality to increase within every single country in the world while global inequality decreases. If you don't believe me, just think about it a minute, and I'll go over this again in a minute. It's possible, despite or because of globalization, for inequality to increase in every single country while globally inequality decreases. I'll explain that in a minute. For example, much of the change in global inequality in the next few decades could result from economic growth in large and lower income countries, e.g. China, India, and Brazil, simply going upwards. So I'm explaining why this is possible. So let's assume we have the developed world here with a spread of inequality, okay, spread of income or wealth inequality, and we have Brazil here and China and India also with a big spread, okay, and they're also individually getting wider in terms of spread. But at the same time, let's say China, which is 20% of the world's population, is just moving up right here. So when you look at the global spread of inequality, 20% of the world's population is getting significantly richer, which means that inequality globally could be getting less while individually the country is becoming more unequal. So it's perfectly possible. The difference between a population level statistical result and a subset phenomena. So as China grows, this could actually reduce global inequality, despite China itself becoming more unequal. This is called Simpson's paradox, or the Ewell-Simpson effect. And one of the famous examples of this is an inquiry in the 70s, I think it was, to alleged gender inequality in the University of California at Berkeley. The aggregate data suggested that women were being discriminated against. Okay, and there was a legal suit brought against the university by someone saying the data suggests that more qualified women are women with equal qualifications have a less chance of getting in to this university. Okay, and the aggregate data showed that quite clearly. So the university reacted to this lawsuit by inquiring into every single department, show us how you're discriminating against women, okay? And to the surprise, they found that every single department was discriminating in favor of women. So it's possible, in other words, men and women of similar qualifications, a woman had a slight advantage of getting in. It's possible for every department to discriminate in favor of women, and globally the effect at the university to be the opposite, discriminating against. Why? Look a bit perplexed. Well, just think about it. Subjects like English or English literature tend to attract a lot of people, and therefore the entrance requirements go up. Okay, other subjects like physics or engineering may be less popular. Okay, so they put the entrance requirements down, and then it was true that the demand for these different subjects between men and women varied. So more women wanted to do subjects like English, and more men wanted to do subjects like engineering and science. But because the demand for English was on the aggregate overall much higher than the capacity they could supply, they put the qualifications up. So women found it tougher to get into their favorite subjects, whereas men found it easier to get into their favorite subjects, like engineering and physics and whatever. And so women were not being discriminated against individually in the departmental level, but there was an aggregate effect which was contrary to what the individual policies were at departmental level. This is another example. This is well-known statistical paradox. It's not actually a paradox. It's the difference between measures at a disaggregated level and statistical measures at a population level. They can, in principle, be different. Hence, with globalization, we could have more equality, less inequality, despite every country being more unequal. And that's the way we're going at present. I mean, I've not got a crystal ball, not predicting the future, but China's rapid growth and India's rapid growth is bringing billions of people out of poverty. And as people are lifted out of poverty, that may actually reduce inequality. So we can't blame globalization for it either. Right, so what are the sources of inequality in capitalism? I'm going to focus on three major sources of inequality. The first one is not so much to do with capitalism as, more specifically, modern capitalism. Marx predicted that capitalism will be associated with de-skilling. He thought that as capitalism developed, the average level of skill for workers would go down. This has been flatly contradicted by the facts. Okay? Although there are examples of de-skilling, we know personal examples from our personal life, we know the creation of things like call centers where people have very routine and boring work. All these things are happening, but all the data suggests that on the average, skill levels are rising. And this is why modern capitalism has to invest much more in education. It's why the number of people going to universities in most developed countries has increased from a tiny elite to 40% in the US, 30% in other countries, and I guess it's getting higher in Brazil too. So there's clear evidence that on the average, skill levels are increasing, or at least over the last 100 years. It does not necessarily mean we can extrapolate into the future. It could change. There's different scenarios. But if the level of skill required to get a good job, level of training required to get a good job is maintained, and a fortiori, if skill levels increase, then a crucial potential generator of inequality is differential access to education. Okay, those that are like you and I are fortunate enough to get to university and to study and get qualifications have disadvantage over those that don't. David was telling me earlier when we were walking around the campus about one of the problems in the Brazilian education system is that you have good universities, but the public sector primary and secondary schools are inferior quality. So the middle classes buy themselves private education for their children. Understandably, we want to do the best for our children. But the poor cannot. And because of the lower quality of public sector primary and secondary schools in Brazil, This means that a large tract of the population are excluded from access or have difficulty of access to higher education. And this is a crucial problem, even for Britain, because maybe the standard of public sector education in Britain is better, though it's far from perfect. There's still localities, there's neighborhoods with poor schools and bad discipline, bad funding, and so on. I'm not often singing the praises of Tony Blair, given his record and various things like the Iraq War, but one thing he said right at the beginning of his period of leadership of the Labour Party is, what three things do you think are most important? And he said, education, education, and education. And I think that's quite an inspired statement about the importance of education. Equal access, in turn, is fed by other things. Inequalities of wealth and income obviously affect access to good schooling. Even if in Britain, even if you send your children to public school, to public sector schools, to state schools, you often manipulate the system by moving into an area where the schools are better. So there's you move away from a neighborhood with poor schools and you buy a house in a neighborhood with a better school. And so even people devoted to public sector education will have better access because they will move to better schools. And so therefore differential in income creates unequal education, which in turn feeds back and creates more inequality. So it's a cumulative process, a feedback loop where these things interact with each other. Now there's a second important difference. So if you think of go back to the question about what generates wealth and how we conceive of wealth generation, and I quickly dismiss the labor theory of value, assuming what it proves, but there are differences between factor inputs, factors of production, as they're called in textbooks. So an owner of capital and an owner of labor power, in the textbook, they arrive at the production function with the labels K and L, okay? And then the both input and the production function tells you what the output is, Cobb-Douglas, whatever. And there appears to be a symmetry. Factors of production are treated equally. But Marshall and other economists noticed that there's an asymmetry. Green was a political theorist, Marshall Hobson, and I didn't notice it, but I published this, one of my early publications, noticed that these people had said the same thing. And it's the fact that the big difference between the owner of capital and the owner of labor is that the owner of capital can then walk away. They can hire up their machines, they can put their money into the project, and then they can go off and do something else while the money or the wealth is generating yet more wealth or more money. Whereas the worker, when they're hiring their labor, has to give up their physical time as well. So that's why I call it corporeal exploitation, is because your body has to go with the service that you actually provide. Whereas the capitalist, this is not the case. Now, I think this is an important source of inequality in capitalism. Because if you want to make money, if you want to do the best for things, if you want to educate your children, give them proper care and nurture and whatever, all these things require time. And the capitalist has time. The capitalist has time to speculate, to find opportunities, to be entrepreneurial. The worker is robbed of time because they have to be present in the process of production. So the two factors are not symmetrical in that sense. And Marshall, giving due credit in the principles, is crystal clear about this. It's a difference between capital and labor. Yet it's not mentioned in the modern textbooks these days. They're more interested in the coefficients and the Cobb-Douglas production function than the underlying asymmetries. I think this is an important source of inequality, but it's also a source of inequality in any system. It's not peculiar to capitalism, but it does actually suggest that things like limitations on the working day in France, 35-hour week and so on. Whether you go that far is a matter of policy debate, but these are important issues. The liberation of time is an important instrument in the battle against inequality. Okay? Giving people the freedom either just to enjoy their leisure or to create the opportunity of generating wealth by other means is an important element. So it's not peculiar to capitalism, but it's something we have to live with in capitalism, and it's a relevant policy to deal with inequality would have to address this issue. So the second point is that. So the first one's education, and this, the second one is to do with time. Okay. Right, the third one I think is perhaps one which is completely neglected, but maybe the most important. Capitalism, as I said, is associated with this ideology of liberté, égalité, and fraternité, of equality under the law and freedom. And equality under the law and freedom mean no slavery. Okay? You can't have slavery. Slavery is the antithesis of freedom. There's an interesting, by the way, discussion amongst libertarians whether voluntary slavery should be allowed. Okay? So if you're a libertarian, if you're an ultra-libertarian, you should say, well, you should be so free as to make yourself unfree. Okay? So you could tolerate selling yourself as a slave. But whether we like it or not, I personally like it, doing that is illegal. Okay? So that's the kind of limitation on my liberty I would prefer to have, not being able to sell myself into slavery or to see others do the same thing. Okay? So the fact of life in modern capitalism, since we've got rid of slavery over the different times, means that actually we're denied a possibility. We cannot use ourselves as collateral. If you have other forms of property, if you have a house or land or a car, you can go to the bank and you can say, I want a loan, please. And they may ask you, what's it for, but whatever. Okay, I want a loan, and then they say, they'll ask you a crucial question. Is this going to be a secured loan or an unsecured loan? I don't know what the terminology is in Portuguese, but you understand my meaning. The secured loan is one where there's collateral for the loan. In other words, if you don't pay the loan back, they seize the asset. So we typically would do this with our house. Okay, get a mortgage. A mortgage is a collateralization agreement. So the wealth we have in our houses or land can be used to borrow money, okay, as collateral through a mortgage. We can do with a car. Now, the other ways we can borrow money, if you're a student, you can go to the bank and say, well, look, I'm doing very, very well at university. I'm likely to be earning all this salary in the future. I've got a job ahead of me. Would you give me a loan on the basis of my future earnings? And they will, quite often. Sometimes a company will actually sign a contract with you, say, well, we will offer you a job after you've finished your degree, and this will be your salary, and these are the conditions, and you'll be work for us for 5 years, and so on. But none of those arrangements involve slavery. They involve some of future limitations. And in the case where you went to the bank and said, I want a loan, on the basis of my future earnings, the bank will say, okay, yes, but they will charge you a higher interest rate because it's an unsecured loan. So they're bearing a greater risk. They haven't got an asset that they can seize if you don't repay the loan. Because of capitalism, they cannot say, well, if you don't repay the loan, we'll make you a slave, okay, and sell you on the slave market and get our money back. They might want to do that, but they can't do that legally in capitalism. Capitalism has, congenitally, in its nature, incomplete futures markets. Capitalism does not have complete markets, and it cannot have. The only way you can make capitalism have complete markets is to allow slavery. which is a contradiction of at least modern capitalism. So what, the owner of other forms of capital, machines, land, houses, all these things, has the ability to use their assets to get money in secured loans through the use of collateral. If we don't own any of those things, even if we're very skilled, we cannot use our own capacities, our labor, our potential labor, our labor power as collateral. We can use it maybe to get a kind of unsecured loan at a higher rate of interest, but we cannot use ourselves as collateral. So again, there's a key asymmetry between labor and capital, the two things that go into the production function. And in the textbooks, we ignore the differences between them, but there's a crucial asymmetry. And I think this is one of the major sources of inequality within capitalism itself. Unequal access to collateral generates further inequality. How does it do it? Quite obviously, because if you're a capitalist, you have wealth, and then you invest that wealth in some enterprise. And then while the enterprise is going on, your factories and machines are producing your widgets or whatever, and you're making money, you can go to the bank and say, look, I've got this enterprise, I've got all these stocks and shares and all this value of stuff. I want to borrow more money on the basis of the collateral I have in that enterprise. And then you borrow more money and you set up another enterprise, and then that generates wealth. And you go to the bank again and say, I want to borrow more money, and so on. So there are cascading possibilities within capitalism, with risks, we know that, things can go wrong, but the possibilities are there if you have non-labor wealth, if you have collateralizable assets. Labor is non-collateralizable, and therefore the worker has nothing else but their own labor, and doesn't have access to it. Now, actually, this is indicates that things that we do own as collateral, like houses, are rather important. And traditionally, the left has denied the importance of that. In the 1980s in Britain, there was a big debate in the Labour Party when Margaret Thatcher started generating the right to buy. The social housing, the public housing, she enacted the right to buy, so people could buy their own homes. And they become private owners in the homes that they were formerly renting. Now, the way she did it was to undermine social provision, but in principle, in hindsight, it was a good thing. So to give workers some property, is that other than their own labor, is actually an important move for people, even though we live in an unequal society, and owning a small house is not that much of a big deal. Anyway, so capitalism is truly biblical in its scope, because we have this wonderful quotation, the Matthew effect, you give to those who have. So if you have collateralizable assets, that generates further wealth for you. So to him who hath. So, my key argument is the foremost generator of inequality under capitalism is not markets, but, in one word, capital. Right, so how do I define capital? I have another chapter in the book, so I can give you another hour talk on it, actually, on this question, about the meaning of the term capital. If you want to hear it, you can come to Rio tomorrow, because I'm giving the talk tomorrow. It's called What is Capital? But to give you the two-minute version of the talk, if you go to the person in the financial district of Sao Paulo and ask them in Portuguese, is it capitale, something like that? So what do you mean by that? Okay, and they say, well, it's business assets. It's the stuff on my balance sheet, which is declarable in some value. It can include tangible or intangible assets, plus the money and other stuff on my balance sheet, all of which I can use to invest or to obtain money as collateral to invest. So that's the meaning of capital which has prevailed since the 13th century. Fernand Braudel, the great French historian, traced the early meanings of the word capital, and he found the first meanings of capitale in Italian, 13th century, referring to this, money or monetizable assets. So if you want to come to my talk tomorrow in Rio, I'll tell you that stuff like human capital and social capital is a misunderstanding of what capital is. And I also talk about how economists and sociologists in a glorious conspiracy changed the meaning of the word. And it started with Adam Smith. Okay? Economists have totally misunderstood the meaning of capital for the last 200 years, Marx included. Okay? Not just him, but all of them. Smith, instead of saying it's monetizable assets or claims, it becomes the assets themselves. So it's because workers can produce things, therefore they have human capital. Because social networks are useful, we call it social capital. But you can't buy or sell these things. I mean, there's Facebook and there's LinkedIn and these other things, which you're not selling the network, you're selling the platform. So we could discuss that in the question. So in the argument, I exclude those. They're not really capital because they're not saleable, and being saleable is a condition for alienable. We can rent our labor, but we can't sell ourselves. We can't enslave ourselves. So if there is human capital, it is slavery. And the first origin of the term human capital is in the context of slavery. So the term human capital originates in the context of slavery. So the true human capital are slaves. So what Becker's meaning is a different meaning. But if you define capital in this way, it's slaves are collateralizable, so slaves can be capital. But if we don't have slavery, we don't have human capital anymore. It has to be this kind of thing. So collateralization is a point which is completely missing. In Marxist economics, Keynesian economics, well, it's a bit in Keynes about it, but it's not prominent at all. It's missing from Schumpeter, it's missing from neoclassical economics, it's missing from Adam Smith and so on. And the source of the problem is that they have a wrong definition of property. We treat property as something we can control, not to which we have legal entitlement. This is all in my book. So if you want to unpack that a bit, we can do that in the questions. So if you define capital this way, then you have the source of inequality being that. Incidentally, there's a book coming out. It's out in French already by Thomas Piketty. And he's getting mainstream acclaim for this book, but that might make you suspicious in many cases, but I would urge you to actually take this book very, very seriously, because it's an economic history of already out in French, if you read French. So watch out for Piketty's work on capital and inequality, because that gives you a similar story. Let's go back to Paine, Thomas Paine. Why do I raise him? Because actually he suggests a number of things which are relevant. The first thing, he was very early advocate of old age pensions, which we now take for granted. But he was realizing that people, when they're older, can't work so hard physically, but they should be entitled to some provision, some means of survival. So although he was not in favor of a strong, big government, he did favor an old age pension. But more radical than that, or more unfamiliar to us than that, is a state-funded distribution to every person when arrived at the age of 21, which was then the age of majority, the sum of £15 sterling as a compensation in part for the loss of her natural inheritance by the introduction of the system of landed property. Now, if you convert this £21, it's about £79,000, or $120,000 as an equivalent share of 2011 GDP. It's not a small amount of money, okay? His political justification of it is interesting, because he says, because it's a pre-industrial, or it's only the beginnings of industrialization. So he sees most wealth of land, and he says, where does land come from? It's basically a gift of God. It's inherited, it's there from the beginning. Yet some people have a very exclusive access to it and generate wealth. We all have the right to this legacy that we get. So it's a kind of natural right argument, which would also apply to other things as well. So it's still relevant. But the beauty of this proposal is that it doesn't create equality, but it creates the possibility of the reduction of inequality by giving people a significant amount of money when they reach the age of majority, which may be 18 now, okay? And then you can use that money for education or investing in a business or whatever. And there's a possibility, because everyone's in the same boat, of some alleviation of the problem, inequality. Well, how do you get the money back? You get it back by inheritance taxes. So you recycle the money. When people die, take the money off and then give it to the younger generation as they come through. So you're not talking about punitive taxation necessarily here, despite the large amount of money involved. Just you could recycle it through inheritance taxes. Now, a modern version of it, and by two Americans, and they cite Paine as an important case, Ackerman, and also the stakeholder society. Now, use the phrase stakeholder, that's used in different ways, but they use the term actually say, well, property is so important that everyone should have a share in it. So, contrary to the socialist view, which traditionally is to abolish private property, they are actually wanting to redistribute wealth and to generate possibilities of further wealth. Hence the term stakeholder society. So they're not against taxes on income, but they put greater emphasis on wealth taxes rather than income taxes. As we know, politically, income taxes are difficult. There's also difficult with any taxes in a kind of society which has libertarian reflexes, but it may be possible to make further inroads on wealth taxes and more difficult to make further inroads on income taxes. They propose the same Paineite solution of a large cash grant to citizens on the age of majority, and general implementation of wealth tax to pay for it. There's also similar proposals by a book that came out in the same year by Bowles and Gintis, which also talks about measures to deal with inequality. And Bowles and Gintis, I think, include a basic income, so the basic income proposal. So you have this large wealth redistribution, but also a basic income entitlement, which is, I know, being discussed in Brazil, which has to be financed somewhere, but it's a useful way of thinking about the problem. Now, I've raised the way in which differential access to knowledge creates a problem or exacerbates a problem of inequality. Well, as capitalism becomes more knowledge intensive, policies to give more equal access to education also become very important. So I think that the obvious conclusion from that diagnosis of part of the problem is to develop the education system and to ensure widespread access. And also you need skill development policies. And there's particularly to deal with job displacement and unemployment, so you don't throw people on the scrap heap. You need retraining. And you also need to give employers incentives to invest in skill development. So it's not just a school system. You need to develop the school system and higher education, of course, as well. But you also need technical skills related to work so that people constantly have the opportunity to develop their own skills. And again, Marshall is interesting on this point because Marshall points out is because you can't tie workers down in the future because you lack a complete futures market for labor, employers, other things be equal, have a disincentive to invest in the workers' skills. Right? We know that many employers do invest in skills, but the risk the employer is taking is that if the worker quits, gets all the skills, get trained up on the firm, that investment by the boss, by the managers of the firm, is lost because it goes to another competing firm. Okay? So what do bosses do? As capitalism becomes more knowledge intensive, the knowledge intensive worker becomes more a prized asset, and they create incentives to keep people in firms. So hence, I think this may be a minority, but those of us which are have qualifications and skills enjoy the benefit of this process, because actually our employers have an incentive to retain us. And so we can bargain individually for better conditions simply because of the benefit that we have in terms of our skill development. So capitalism has to deal with that problem, and there's also a role for state-sponsored training or state subsidies to employer training. Well, I mentioned the basic income guarantee proposal. Now look at these names, ranging what we call left to right, Hayek and Friedman on the so-called right, Galbraith left, others, right across the board. So some of these proposals actually challenge our traditional views of left and right. And it leads me towards the some of the last points I want, but I would also raise Paine's, for my final quotation from Paine, is all accumulation therefore of personal property beyond what a man's own hands produce is derived to him by living in society, and he owes on every principle of justice, of gratitude, and of civilization a part of that accumulation from whence the whole came. There's not an argument for private ownership, for public ownership, for nationalisation. It's an argument of justice, that we are fortunate to live in a society where past generations have built things up for us. They've created institutions, they've created wealth, and we benefit from that. So our capacities, our skills, our abilities are partly result of the benefit we have in that society. So we all live in a society where we owe to others from the present and past. And that's the principle of justice involved behind this, which doesn't necessarily mean nationalisation or public ownership. So the last part of my talk is to talk beyond, I want to talk about how this challenges our conventional views of left or right. This is a picture of the French Assembly in the 1790s, and it looks chaotic, and I think it was, during that particular period of the French Revolution. The terms, as you probably know, the terms left and right derive from the French Revolution, from one particular phase of it, which is actually immediately after the fall of the Bastille of 1789. Because then in the Parliament there were a group which were seated on the right of the President of the Assembly, wanted to keep the monarchy, and there was a group on the left that wanted to get rid of it. And then what happened is that the monarchists were purged, and they had to move over, and the Girondists were purged, and they had to move over. Progressively, the meanings of these terms changed. But originally, the right meant tradition, privilege, inequality under the law, monarchy, etc. And left meant equality, fraternity, liberty. Not nationalisation, though. So Paine would have sat on the left. In fact, Paine did was given a seat in the National Assembly, and he sat on the right because he was a Girondist. But Girondists were also quite libertarian and anti-monarchist, because things have shifted over. So it's a complicated story. But what happened after that is the term left, thanks to these gentlemen and others, changed its meaning. Before they entered the scene, actually, by 1900, left meant common ownership of the means of production, and then Stalin and Mao are seen as left because of that shift of meaning. But the term right also shifted to the defense of free markets and private ownership. So we describe Hayek as right, maybe wrongly, but that's a typical description, and Milton Friedman and the American Tea Party and so on. So people that advocate free markets and private ownership are described as right, not conservative anymore, okay? Because conservatism means defense of the status quo, defense of privilege, defense of inequality. The American right currently, most of them anyway, are libertarians, Tea Party types, and then they are maybe stupid, but they're not conservative. So Hayek, for example, is called right, but actually, if Hayek went back in a time machine, his economic policies in revolutionary France would have placed him on the left. Because hardly anybody, I don't know of anybody in the French Assembly in the 1790s advocating public ownership. They all advocated markets and private ownership. And actually for breaking up big monopolies and having small firms, very much like Hayek. So the right comes to occupy the territory formerly occupied by the left. So the whole meaning's become inverted. And I'm suggesting, really, we have to think outside this language. An argument I just put to you is that what happened, so Paine was a radical, and the left of the French Assembly were radicals, but then socialism arrives and says, well, the problem is private ownership. And so the abolition of private ownership becomes the foremost thing, and that's becomes the meaning of the label of the left. It's understandable in the time to blame private property as a problem, but I think it was a strategic error. It was a wrong turning for the radical movement at the time. And so if we go back in time, we can argue that we have an alternative radical route. And even if we take a private enterprise view, a view which involves accepting a system which has private ownership and markets, we can also derive social democratic conclusions from it. Because people, to function in such a society, we have private ownership, you need to have the means of subsistence, the needs of subsistence, in food and housing. Otherwise, you're spending all your life dealing with very basic things and you can't do anything else. And so you can make a kind of libertarian argument for a welfare state. So free market principles, you could argue, imply a welfare state. Because without a welfare state, you can't deal with this problem of people not being able to operate properly in a market or free enterprise society. So it doesn't follow from free market arguments that we have to oppose a welfare state, although many people do, of course. So there are limits to markets, and there's a need for a welfare state. We can discuss, I'm running out of time, I've run over my time, arguments to do with externalities, destabilization and so on, suggest that markets can't be everywhere, so there's limits to the role of markets. And also as a good argument for a welfare state. And crucially, by pushing back slavery and establishing a system of wage labor, capitalism limited the market at its core, disallowed complete futures markets for labor power. So capitalism itself limits the markets. And because of the ban of slavery, workers cannot be used as collateral for obtaining loans, and they cannot be separated from the labor in production, which creates the problem for capitalism. So the central problem in capitalism is inequality, not private ownership. And it's policies to deal with inequality which we have to discuss, not just in Brazil, but in every major country. And that's a quick advertisement for the book, where all these arguments are going to be rehearsed when the book's published. So thank you very much for your time. I've spent much more than I thought.
like just to start by telling a story about a lecture that Tony Giddens gave at Cambridge when he was still there, and he referred to the Brazilianization of the British society. So it's happening everywhere. Right? So we have time for questions and comments. If someone is not comfortable with speaking English, you can ask the question in Portuguese and I can translate.
Yes. Thank you for your presentation. I will not have an argument with you on the maps theory of value because first there is no space here to discuss, and to some extent it would somewhat mean reinventing the wheel, this kind of discussion. I prefer to focus on the one you mentioned of this very brilliant economist of the World Bank, Branko Milanović. Milanović, during the 90s, was courageous enough and strong enough to fight from within the World Bank the then motto which claimed that globalization was rising up revenue and converging revenue, as the English used to say, the tide raised all the boats. So I think it was quite interesting, and recently you mentioned his paper in 2011 or so. He published a book, a paper basically stating that place war has replaced class war. That means that if you are in place like Brazil, you have very little chance to become rich. I am not sure that the wealthy people living in São Paulo or in Mexico, what I call the are not member of what I call the international of frontier. I mean, I'm not sure that the way of life, the standard of life in São Paulo, Mexico, or as other cities in the third world, are not comparable to very French wealthy. But it's not my point. The point of Milanović in his last paper is to claim that because of that, because place war has replaced class war, there is no class struggle any longer. So what pinpoint correctly in my view Milanović is that there is no place in the really existing globalization for people of the third world to catch up or even to take over developed countries. I mean, it's quite correct because my analytical framework is not a kind of stagist theory or catching up theory, but a kind of combined and uneven development at the world level. So I think that we are in this world a combination of inequality and in the meantime, globalization. It's not, in my view, a rebuttal of the class, of the class struggle. It's a rebuttal of the Stagist theory. I mean, Milanović evidenced himself very brilliantly that inequalities are increasing, of course, even among and within developed countries. So, of course, we can not speak of class struggle, but the fact that inequality has also increase within, relatively increase in OECD countries, in my view, is somewhat evident that there is a kind of ongoing class warfare. And Warren Buffett, philanthropic tycoon, US tycoon, said, yes, the three last decades have been about a class warfare, and we, Warren Buffett, my colleague, wants this class of. So in fact, my first question, do you think that the fact that there is no catching up process in the average income in the world dismiss this kind of class struggle within country, even in developed country? And my second question is also about Milanović. Milanović put forward another seem to speak, and not like assume, he claimed that to some extent, instead of what Marx and Trotsky, because he quotes Marx and Trotsky in his paper, at odds with what Martin Trotsky said, that there is a kind of international solidarity between workers, between exploited people. No, no, Nero forgets that. People are entrenching within their boundary. The basic point by Milanovic is to say that absent significant macroeconomic growth in developing countries, the only way to convert revenue is to promote migration. And he criticized to some extent the fact that the workers of the developed countries are worrying of migration. So I think he is right. Unfortunately, it's a tragedy in Europe, especially that the local worker, feels that it is or her main enemy is the poor Romania, the poor Algerian, the poor Tunisian. I think it's a real tragedy, and you will see in the forthcoming European election. But on the other way, you could consider that migration and massive migration has always been, and to some extent could be, in the context of neoliberal globalization, a way to just promote by business, by capitalism, a kind of race to the bottom. I mean, immigration has always been used by ruling classes as a way to divide people. So I am in favor of immigration, no doubt about that, but could you not understand, could we not understand why, for instance, European workers are so worried with migration, because they feel that in the context of this globalization, not in general globalization, but in this globalization in which wealthy people are offshoring their wealth in Switzerland and other fiscal paradise, maybe we could understand that poor people and poor unemployed in Europe are pretty worried with migration in Europe because of this kind of neoliberal globalization. So what is your opinion?
What is my opinion of Milankovic? I didn't raise it, I just talked about his data. Okay, I just simply cited his data. And from what you say, you have no argument with his data. So I'm simply saying he collected some data and this is what the data says. I didn't quote him on place war or class war or anything else, okay, or on immigration, I didn't mention it. I just used his data. So you have to ask him those questions, not me. Okay, I will answer you then. Okay, I don't like the phrase class war. Okay, because rights are universal. Right? Class war is the instrument of dictatorship. It's a phraseology of Mao and Stalin, who put people to death because they called kulaks or capitalist rodents or whatever. Human rights are universal. We have to get rid of the language of class war. It's one of the worst legacies of Marxism. Time and time again, it's led to totalitarianism, destruction, arbitrary death. It is not class war. It's about human rights. And the poor person in Brazil and the poor person in my country has rights. That's the basis of dealing with inequality. Because if you put people on the street, if you don't give them access to education, if you don't enable them to use their talents to the full, it's their rights are being challenged. Class war is a dangerous instrument of oppression, that terminology. And I'm for raising the poor up. And if you call that class war, okay, it's a different meaning, okay? We have to get rid of this language of class struggle. If we've learned nothing from the 20th century. Read what happened in China, read what happened in the Soviet Union. And don't gloss it over and say, well, it would be better when we have our revolution. I don't believe it. Every case, the language of class war is an excuse for one group to put another group to death simply because they're alleged to be kulaks or rich or whatever. Human rights are universal. That's what I think about it.
Okay, I have no agreement with that.
No agreement or disagreement?
No, I have no argument with that.
No argument. Good, we agree. Excellent. Yeah. Yeah.
Any more questions? Comments?
Well,
Yeah.
Reading inequality. But if I understood well your argument, is that as long as there are some poor countries that are catching up,
yeah,
and so the international inequality between the countries is decreasing.
No.
Is that your
No, it's not between countries. When you say global, it's possible in principle for inequality to increase in every single country and global inequality between individuals to decrease. Okay, so it's not inequality between countries, which is necessary. So you have to get the same basis of measurement. Inequality between individuals within countries can increase, while global inequality between individuals decreases. It's just statistically possible. I'm not saying I'm in favor or against it, I'm saying it's statistically possible. It's counterintuitive, but if we know our statistics, we can realize it. It's called the Simpson-Yule effect. Or
one thing that you need to that helps that is that you have poor people in large countries which are growing.
Exactly right.
Like China. And
yeah, that's right.
But anyway, everybody lives in a specific country. So as it comes to political effects, inequality, do you think that globalization might increase, not that it's not impossible that it increase inside every country, and on the other hand, inequality in a global scale is increasing, of course. I agree with the data.
Okay.
But do you think that globalization is a source of increase in inequality inside each and every country? Because if it is, it's important to also
absolutely
some kind of obstacle to
Absolutely. I mean, there's a number of questions, quite rightly. I mean, I talked about the problem of inequality within countries, and that's, I agree with you, has to be dealt with, okay? My argument vis-a-vis globalization, not for or against it, was that we can't blame increasing inequality on globalization, right? But that doesn't mean globalization is good or bad, right? We have to assess globalization in its own terms. And personally, I'm with Danny Roderick's argument that we shouldn't extend globalization because the effects on things like democracy and other political institutions would be negative. So I'm not for hyper-globalization, okay? But that's for different reasons. I'm simply saying we cannot blame inequality necessarily on globalization. Globalization does not automatically lead to greater inequality, right? Because it's that's what I'm saying. I'm not saying I'm pro globalization or against. It's statistically possible that globalization leads to greater equality, while every country getting more unequal. The problem is inequality globally and within countries, and we have to deal with those problems. Now, the argument for limiting globalization, which I'm in favor of, limiting globalization, is a different kind of argument. It's not saying I'm against inequality, therefore I'm against globalization. That's illogical. I'm against hyper-globalization for other reasons. Yeah? Because of the problem it does to national autonomy, local rights, and all these things. There's a real challenge to political democracy and putting power in large corporations which globalize. There's other reasons for being cautious, at least, about globalization. What I'm saying is you can't be anti-globalization on principle because it automatically leads to inequality. It doesn't.
Okay, Jeff, if I may, on that line, I'll get back to you in a moment.
Yeah.
What about, I agree, I think I understood your point, and I agree, you cannot blame it on globalization. General, but what about one particular aspect of globalization in recent decades, which is competition between countries, so that in countries where
first
state
absolutely
policies competing against other countries which don't have that, then in European countries and other places, some rights or some parts of the welfare state policies have been reduced or eliminated in order to increase competitiveness.
And
that contributes to inequality, right?
Yeah, a race to the bottom in terms of welfare state regimes. That's one reason why I'm against hyper-globalization, because it erodes standards you've established in the more social democratic
That's
countries.
That's not inherent in any globalization.
Exactly. It's happening because of the nature of the globalization process. Another example which shows you the double-edged nature of this. So one of the big changes in the British economy is the virtual destruction of the manufacturing sector. Okay. So I can remember 50 years ago where the working class was a manual working class and there was employed and unemployed, and their route to a job was typically through various forms of manual work, skilled or unskilled manual work. Now a lot of that has been completely destroyed within Britain, and you've got the creation of this underclass in British society which live off the welfare state, and there's drug abuse and all this stuff. I mean, same in the US. Now, where have those jobs gone? They've gone to China. Okay, so Britain has become more unequal because of that, whereas in China, that also has become more unequal, but a lot of poorer peasants have got better off because of the growth of manufacturing in China. So it's actually a complex story. If you take Britain and China together, probably the equality's got slightly less because a lot of poor peasants have got richer, a huge number of them. But both countries have got more unequal through globalization. So the globalization story is complicated. All I'm saying is you can't be against globalization in principle, because in principle it always generates inequality. It doesn't. There's other good reasons to be against globalization.
I didn't mean to prevent you from
Certainly, I would ask exactly about the possibility of capital to make arbitrage between wages and labor rights and social rights because of the difference in the capital mobility and labor mobility.
Yeah.
And I think that's a fact that's built in our kind, specific kind of globalization that contributes to rising inequality.
Yeah, another argument against globalization is the infinite industry argument. I mean, developing countries like Brazil, and I mean, Brazil has now established key industries, but to say African countries, which is beginning to develop, African countries find it very, very difficult to develop industry because they're immediately faced with the competitive challenge in a global market of large established corporations, which got to the level of technology and whatever. And so it's the infant industry argument to restrict trade, for tariffs or trade limitations, to enable the poorer countries to establish their industries, build up the skill level, and then compete. It's Ha-Jun Chang's argument about kicking away the ladder, the developmental process. Because that's what Britain did and America did and Germany did right at the beginning. We protected, then built our trade up, and then competed, and bashed everybody and by competition, by globalization. So there's all sorts of good arguments for limiting globalization, okay? But not on the grounds that it inevitably creates inequality. Sure.
Definition of capitalism.
Okay.
Because let me explain what I'm trying to say. If you take your definition of capital as money, basically money and everything that can be sold, is capitalism the social system of capital?
Mm-hmm.
So is capitalism eternal? Because money, we have money all over history. And this is a complication about the Marxist definition of capitalism. This is what I'm trying to understand. What's your perception of capital?
Well, I think that's a very good question, okay? I did give you a rough definition of capital, but I didn't give you a definition of capitalism, and I think your question is a very good one, okay? Again, I'm going to advertise the book. In the book, there's an argument for a definition of capitalism, okay? Now, it's true that money has been around for a long time. It's not been eternal, but it's been around for thousands of years. So if capital was simply money and capitalism was simply a money society, then we would have had capitalism for thousands of years. Some people think like that, but it's not what I think, okay? The crucial thing about collateralization of property, though, is very recent. The ability to use property as collateral is a very recent development. It's still not properly established in Brazil, because the tenants in the favelas, in the slum areas in Rio de Janeiro and elsewhere and around Sao Paulo, they don't have proper title to the land. They can't use what they're using as collateral. And De Soto and others, various political positions, Fernando De Soto and others argue this is a key to development, to create collateralizable property. Now, I think there's something in that argument, okay? So creation of collateralizability, which is a long, awkward word, the ability to mortgage your property is a relatively recent development. Things also like the sale of debt, which is tied up with the story, and the accounting methods used so you can actually talk about the capital value of things, are a few hundred years old, 300 years old roughly, okay? No longer than that. So all those elements which are part of the story of the collateralization aspect are recent. So one possibility is we do define capitalism in those terms, but we get a very recent picture of what capitalism is. It's 300 years old. In the book, I make an additional argument, and this time I'm with Marx, because I think the existence of an employment relationship is also a characteristic feature of our modern society. Not that everyone is in an employment relationship, but employment relationships are fairly commonplace. I'm an employee of my university, but not just contract, an employment relationship. An employment contract is a different kind of contract. It involves asymmetrical authority, because we don't fully specify what we're going to do in the contract. So it's not like cleaning windows or buying a car. Those are contracts, but employment contracts have this flexibility and asymmetric authority. And in law, it means that the employer has the right of detailed interference in what we do. Now, employment contracts are also quite old. They're not thousands of years old, but they're hundreds of years old. But if you combine those two things together, you get close to Marx's definition of capitalism. And this means capitalism is 250 years old, roughly, 200 or 300 years old. And so you're in the same ballparks as a Marxist view of how you define it. So I make the argument in the book, it's not part of this story of inequality, but I make the argument in the book that we should add the specification of employment contracts being characteristic of capitalism, as Marx does, because this is a key part of modern society. Incidentally, Schumpeter is another example, because Schumpeter doesn't do that. So I have point in the argument, I have two definitions. One I call M capitalism, where you have employment, this is M after Marx. M capitalism is where you include the employment relationship. Schumpeter is where you exclude it, because Schumpeter explicitly says capitalism is about financial institutions. There used to be a chain in Britain, or there is still a chain called M&S, Marks and Spencer's. So M&S capitalism is where you have the two things together, which is the definition I prefer. So using this definition of capital plus employment relationships. Okay. Yeah.
We have this government handout called Bolsa Familia. Mm-hmm. It's from the Lula government, where you send your children to school, you get a scholarship or a government handout.
Yeah.
And it seems that it's been criticized because you give people fish instead of telling them how to fish. But also, and the Gini coefficient has proved that, I suppose, that it's become a little better. So we have less inequality in Brazil over the last few years. It's become better. Do you have an opinion? Have you looked at this?
I don't know the detail. I mean, from afar, I've followed the change of government, the Lula government, and the subsequent presidential regime, and I've seen some of the problems. So people tell me it's about some of the problems and some of the difficulties and protests, but also some of the successes. So from my point of view, across the other side of the world, it's a mixed picture with some good things, and the fact they've reduced Gini coefficient is a good thing. I think the anti-poverty program is not being completely successful, but it's a good way of thinking. It's a good strategic. It's good to highlight this issue and to deal with it. I'll be very interested to learn more about it. I'm particularly concerned about access to education in Brazil. I'm also interested in experiments you've had with basic income schemes, discussions about that. There's some discussion in Brazil about basic income, as I understand. So there are political interesting things going on, but I don't know enough about the detail. I'm happy to learn more about it.
Jeff, I personally would like just to we are running out of time, but I would like to say something about that. One thing that doesn't appear in the data that you use and many people use is the part of social provision that's not provided by the market.
Yes, right?
You talk about inequality, income inequality, but that involves money and capital. But there are parts of the social provisioning process that may not go through income and wealth.
Yeah.
And that varies according to the varieties of capitalism that has changed over time.
Yeah.
And I'm not an expert on that, but I think that in many places there has been a decrease in social provision, in non-market social provision, right, in Europe and other places.
Yeah.
So that may be an important part of problem that you're discussing, because at least in part, because people need to use money to buy things that they didn't need to buy anymore. So in terms of welfare, not inequality, but in terms of welfare, the kind of social provision that is made and its effect on welfare depends on whether it's provided by the market or not, and whether people have income and wealth to buy things when it's provided by the market.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, of course, in most countries you've had these attempts to privatize aspects of welfare provision. I'm particularly forcefully in my country under both Labour and Conservative governments. I'm not sure, though, that you can say, just simply factually, leaving aside one's view for and against it, that the amount of provision by the market has increased. Okay, there's been a relentless attack of privatization of various services, but in Britain over the last 30, 40 years, but I'm not sure. But at the same time, the welfare state's increased. So we need to unpack that issue. So, so even with the National Health Service, where there's little bits that have been hived off and there's various insurance schemes coming on, when I go to the doctor, I don't pay for it. The National Health System, I don't pay for anything. I pay anything at all. Or even for prescription. So you could privatize parts of the provisioning service while the person, the consumer, is actually still in a non-market relationship with the health service itself. So it's actually a complicated picture. But I fully generally against the idea that privatization is an efficiency solution to everything. And I think that I've looked at health economics, and the arguments are in favor of this kind of using a market as a solution to all problems are actually very weak. We really need to do hard work and to get data on the way these services actually operate in reality and stop using the market as a panacea. Incidentally, if capitalism depends on incomplete markets, my argument it does, because capitalism inevitably has incomplete markets. Standard general equilibrium theory tells us that there's a few people who've worked on incomplete markets in general equilibrium theory. Is that actually you're bound to be, that market system is bound to be suboptimal. So the conclusion from mainstream economics is that capitalism is suboptimal. There's a secondary conclusion, mainstream economics tells you, is if you try and increase market provision in an economy where there's incomplete markets, it's highly possible that you could make the situation less optimal than before, or less efficient than before. So if we use a mainstream general equilibrium theory, actually we get an argument against privatization. And the people learn general equilibrium theory. If you go to a mainstream economics department, you're learning general equilibrium theory and all the theorems, existence truths and Arrow de Boer models and all the rest of it, and they won't tell you that under capitalism markets are incomplete. And so the issue of incomplete markets is hived off as a sort of technical expertise area which you do after you've got your PhD degree and you specialise on and you do obscure articles that nobody takes notice of. But actually, the literature tells you that markets can't work perfectly. So we can actually use mainstream theory against free market solutions.
Well, I guess that we should. And now, so thank you very much, Jeff, for your talk and discussion. Thanks, everybody. See you next time.